With its two cores operating at 480 and 240 MHz, the Arduino Portenta H7 is the most powerful Arduino we've seen here so far. This model was recently created for use in high-end applications such as industrial equipment, computer vision systems, and other professional devices. Hence, we now have display and Ethernet capabilities, but more importantly, we now have a dual-core processor. Specifically, it's the STM32H7. In part 1, we installed a few hardware drivers and used the standard Arduino IDE to blink the onboard light-emitting diode. We did this using the ARM Cortex-M7 core, but not the M4. To get the most out of this platform, we want to find out how to use the M7 core and the M4 simultaneously. With other Arduino platforms, we could achieve some concurrency through techniques such as interrupts or multi-threading. This was the case for resources such as the official scheduler library. But today, we'll take this idea even further by running two different sketches in parallel. We'll build on part 1 by getting the M7 core to blink red, getting the M4 core to blink green, and finally, we'll alter this sketch so that we can do things besides just blink the LEDs. If you missed out on part 1, consider watching that video first. Back then, we had to upgrade to the latest Arduino IDE, and also make sure that our drivers were working properly. You'll know you're ready for part 2 when you can plug in the Portenta H7 and see the resulting COM port. If you double-click the reset button on the board while it's still plugged in, you should also see the board transition from normal mode to bootloader mode. This will be indicated by the green LED going into a breathing pattern, followed by your computer recognizing the Portenta as a new USB hardware device. Go ahead and plug in your board if you haven't already, and if it is in bootloader mode, get it back to normal by unplugging it and then plugging it back again. As with anything else electronic, this is best done with anti-static equipment, such as a grounded wristband or a grounded mat. And, as a side note, you'll notice my board now has pin headers attached. This was an optional move on my part. If you don't have an immediate need for pins, just ignore them, because they aren't required for this procedure. If you do plan on adding them, think first about how you plan to use the high-density connectors on the bottom. These are meant for the carrier board and potentially other equipment. And with that out of the way, we can get started. The official example, which came from the website, will generate a sequence of three colors. Red, using only the M7 core, green, using only the M4, and yellow, when red and green are both active. That last one is a color mixing effect because that part number doesn't include a yellow emitter. We can also expect the yellow state to be brighter than the others. For the red pattern, we'll have the M7 blink the light with a period of 400 milliseconds. Specifically, 200 milliseconds on and 200 milliseconds off. For the green, we'll have the M4 blink with a period of 1000 milliseconds, in the same fashion, half of the time on and half of the time off. It's also worth noting that for these LEDs, sending a binary low means we're turning the device on. In the Arduino IDE, create a new sketch, and you might as well name it something like blink red LED M7. As usual, we'll start with the setup function that runs only once when the device first boots up. Here, we'll add a pin mode command to set the LED pin as an output, and then we can move down to the loop function. Now, we want to add a digital write command. This will command the red LED to turn on by setting it low. And we'll also add a comment labeling that. Next, we want to add that 200 millisecond delay. That will use the delay function. Third, we want to do another digital write to turn the LED off. And finally, we add a second delay of equal duration. Add a few more comments, double check everything, and with that, we've completed the code for the M7. Now we can hit the upload button, bearing in mind that uploading will also cause the code to compile. If you run into any trouble, double check your COM port number because it can change from time to time. Also, it's worth double checking that you have the correct core installed and that your system is no longer in bootloader mode. In this case, I ran into an upload error, but it was probably caused by a completely different device connected to my computer that generates some trouble from time to time. When everything is complete, you should see a long report ending in a message saying file downloaded successfully. Now it's time to start working on the M4 core. Leave this sketch open and highlight everything and copy everything so that we can just paste it straight into the M4 sketch. Create a new sketch with a new name and then paste in the old code. Luckily, we only have to make a few alterations. We want to change the durations from 200 to 500 for both lines. We want to change LEDR to LEDG. And like before, we just want to double check everything, adjust any comments if necessary, and then we're ready to upload again. Double check your COM ports in case anything changed, and the code should be well on its way. Give it a few seconds, and like before, we should see a fairly lengthy report followed by the text saying, file downloaded successfully. Now things are a little interesting because if we check the device, we're only going to see it blinking red but not green. This indicates that only the M7 core is running, even though we uploaded code to both. To fix that, we need to issue a command from the M7 that allows the M4 core to run. Open the M7 code again, and in the setup function, enter the command ll_rcc_force_cm4boot. You can also get a copy of this code from the official Arduino website or from our own blog. Add a comment if you want to. And like before, we just double check everything before uploading the code. Upload, and within a few seconds, you should see the three color sequence blinking like we expect. Notice that we didn't have to re-upload the M4's code, we just needed to enable it. Now what we have is certainly functional, but is it practical? The delay function is a blocking function that won't allow anything in our own program to run until it completes its time interval. But the library contains other timekeeping resources. One of these is the milliseconds function, spelled M-I-L-L-I-S, and anytime it's called, it will return the uptime of the Arduino in milliseconds. It does this by counting up from zero, and even though it will roll over back to zero after many days, we can use it to do all the timekeeping for us. All we need to do is check it frequently, and it will signal us when it's time to change the LED. Go back to the red LED code for the M7 core, and luckily our setup function is just fine as it is. Above the function, we want to create an integer called LEDState. This will store the desired state of the LED. And then we want to create an unsigned long variable. This will serve as part of our timekeeping mechanism. And finally, we'll create a constant value that will store our time interval in milliseconds. We'll add a few comments here and there so that we know what's going on. And then we can move down to the loop function, clear everything within it, and create a new unsigned long variable called currentMillis. Let's also have that line assign the value from the milliseconds function to that variable. Bear in mind that the second part, the assignment, will happen every time that the loop iterates. Next, we want to add a conditional statement that will test whether or not it's time to actually invert the LED state. For this, we'll create an if statement, and we'll check for the difference between the current millisecond state, the previous state, and whether that difference exceeds or meets our switching interval. If it is time to do an update, first, we want to store the previous value so that we can do another comparison when it's time again. Next, we want to use the conditional operator, also known as the question mark, to test the current state of the LED. If the state is low, then we assign the state to a high value, basically inverting it. If the state is high, then we set it low. Finally, we'll take that LED state variable and use the digital write command to copy that state to the physical pin attached to the LED. We'll double check everything, add a semicolon to that one line that's missing it, double check our commentary, and we can upload. As a side note, I did once try uploading code to both the M7 core and the M4 at once, and it did generate an error. So it looks like we do have to be patient. And with the M7 code updated, we can highlight everything to copy it, and then go back to the M4 code. Like before, this M4 code is very similar to the M7 code, with just a few exceptions. For starters, we can get rid of the force boot command. Secondly, we can change the time interval from 200 milliseconds to 500 milliseconds. We change all occurrences of LEDR to LEDG, and optionally, we can update our commentary. Double check everything, and then hit upload. Give it a few seconds, and again, if your COM port has changed, you might need to adjust it. Check the board, and you should see the expected color sequence again. If you want, you can check whether or not this is just the old code using the delay method by altering the intervals. But if that were the case, you likely would have seen errors by now. The LEDs are now blinking like before, but the timing is now controlled by a non-blocking function that lets us do other things. Just like in part 1, using the dual core features was really no harder than having two Arduinos plugged in at once, now that we only had one cable to worry about. This three-color sequence could be useful in the future, since it gives us an easy way to check whether both cores are running as expected. It's simple, but effective, and even if the user might have trouble with color distinction, you can use the timing and the cadence of the lights to tell if things are working or not. And speaking of both cores working, you might wonder if they can communicate directly to each other. As one option, you can use remote procedure calls, and if that's not your style, we could see more methods in the future. Finally, it's worth planning for what might happen when both cores need to use a shared resource at the same time, or when one overwrites one resource after the other. This is a best practice for concurrent systems, and this topic is so rich that it's practically its own sub-branch of reliability engineering at this point. If you found this useful, consider joining us on Patreon, where we have a monthly poll and lessons learned on technical builds like this one. The poll for August 2020 basically wants to know if videos like this one should be translated to languages beyond English. Stay posted for more projects in electronics, robotics, IoT, and communication systems, and as always, have a great day!